Welcome to the Osmosis Daily Report on the coronavirus pandemic. I'm Dr. Rishi Desai, I'm the Chief Medical Officer here at Osmosis. I'm also a pediatric infectious disease physician, and I used to work at the CDC in the Division of Viral Diseases looking at virus outbreaks. Today we're going to talk about human challenge studies. To get us started, I wanted to make sure that everyone is on the same page about what phases of studies for vaccines are really looking at. And so there's this great breakdown here. And you can see that there's a clinical trial phase 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are Roman numerals. Phase 1 is really looking at safety, and you want to look at things like side effects of the vaccine. Phase 2 is immunogenicity, and the primary focus there would be things like, you know, do you really see an immune response when someone gets the vaccine? Phase 3 and 4 often get confused for each other. Phase 3 is efficacy, and phase 4 is effectiveness. Now, efficacy is looking at things like, does this work in a controlled setting? Whereas effectiveness is saying, does this work in the real world? And this paper actually gets into the nitty-gritty of the distinction between efficacy and effectiveness. So again, imagine you have a controlled setting, like a research trial, where people have to take the vaccine, maybe they're required to because that's part of the participation in the trial. You're going to see a great efficacy, but then you go and try to deploy it in a country where maybe a lot of people just choose not to, or maybe there's a logistical issue, like maybe all the refrigerators are not working to the right temperature, and the vaccine simply isn't effective. There you would see a low effectiveness, even though, again, in the controlled trial, you're seeing a high efficacy. So this paper came out in the Journal of Infectious Diseases. It's a great paper. I encourage you to read it. It's about human challenge studies, and this is something that has now caught wind, and a lot of people are talking about it, especially politicians, as to figure out a way to expedite or speed up vaccine delivery. So here they talk about the fact that vaccine trials can take 12 to 18 months, and a lot of that time is in the phase 3 part of the study, the efficacy part. And it can take thousands of folks that you vaccinate or give placebo to, and then you follow over time. And that time that you're following them is what takes so much time, because you're waiting to see how many people in each of those two groups are gonna get disease naturally. So they propose another approach, and it's called human challenge studies, and they say, you know, a couple of key things. You really want to pick out previously uninfected people, which makes sense, with a low risk of complications or mortality from SARS-CoV-2. So people that are not having any comorbid illness, are not immunocompromised, and are generally younger. And the other half of this is you want to pick people who are at substantial risk of natural exposure to SARS-CoV-2. So maybe they live in an area where there's lots of, you know, COVID-19 circulating. That's someone that's therefore at substantial risk of getting it naturally. So here's a key thing about human challenge studies, the thing that makes them so different. In these studies, you're giving people, healthy people, the virus, which is not done normally. So here you're not just watching to see if they naturally get infected, which is what was happening with the phase 3 and phase 4 studies. Here you're giving them the virus. You actually inoculate them with virus. And as a step one here, you need to figure out the dose of virus to give. And you want to make sure you give enough so that people get sick, but not so much that they get severely sick, more so than they would get with kind of natural circulating infection. So that first step is to figure out what that dose should be. And you do that with human beings. So step two is to take the individuals that you have identified to be part of your study, give them either placebo or vaccine, and then once they've gotten that, then you give them the viral dose that you've just identified as being enough to get them potentially sick. So once that's done, step three is you watch and see if the vaccine protected these individuals more than the placebo did. And if anyone gets sick, you give them state-of-the-art care. You give them all the monitoring they need to make sure they don't get too sick, and you give them any therapies that might be available to make sure that if they do get sick, that they're going to be on the mend. Finally, step four is if it does prove to be efficacious, if you're seeing good results, then you would start a larger trial. And in this larger trial, you might have upwards of 3,000 people per this report. And in this one, just to be very clear, this study does not involve a challenge. You're not giving a virus at this point. You're just seeing if there's safety and efficacy in larger numbers than what you've already looked at. So taken together, we have to look at obviously the pros and the cons of this approach. And the pros are laid out here. They say that essentially if you do a human challenge study, and if this gets a vaccine to market quicker, this could potentially still help with the COVID-19 pandemic and save thousands, if not millions, of lives. The cons of this approach, I think, are fairly obvious in the sense that we don't usually give healthy people a virus. And so that's an obvious risk, and that would be the ethical issue that you'd have to consider here. Now, they do, in this discussion here, talk about ways in which you can mitigate that risk. And so they say specifically picking individuals that are healthy and low risk of getting severely ill, and then picking them from communities where they likely would have gotten the virus anyway because they were circulating at a high level, plus the fact that you're monitoring them aggressively, you're treating them with, you know, state-of-the-art medications that may be available. These are all ways to make sure that we enhance safety if possible. Now, when I first came across this idea of human challenge studies, my immediate thought was, have these been done before? And so I looked at the WHO. It turns out that they have a whole article on this, and I want to kind of pick out a few key points that the WHO says about human challenge studies. So first, they talk about the importance of doing this in a very controlled setting in a medical environment where you can offer monitoring and treatment, and also you can ensure that this disease is not going to spread beyond the person you're actually infecting. First, the WHO notes that this has actually been done in low and middle income countries, and that the standards of care should be the same as if you're doing it in a more developed setting or high income country. They also point out that if you're going to do it, make sure that your clinical facility can do it in a way that offers good monitoring and treatment to the people that are getting infected, but also that there's no chance of spread of disease. And they finally make one key point, which comes up over and over again when you read the ethical arguments around this, which is, what is the direct benefit to the person who's getting infected, and is there any that would substantiate these risks that they're taking on? And they say, well, in some cases, actually developing immunity to a disease in a very controlled way where you're monitored and get treatment in case, you know, things go awry could be considered an advantage or a benefit. And so they point that out here as well. So in sum, I think what we're realizing here is, and the WHO sums it up quite nicely, is that the idea of human challenge studies has been around, it's been done before, it certainly could be done with COVID-19, and we have to kind of look at these trade-offs in terms of the risk to individuals that are going to be potentially enrolling in these studies versus the benefit to society if vaccine gets out quicker. So I hope you enjoyed that. Thanks for tuning in. Hit the red subscribe button and the bell icon to get daily updates. Please check out osmosis.org/COVID-19 for all of our resources. Remember to help us with raising the line and flattening the curve. Do your part. We're all in this together.